for the second day session at the LTMMC. Now we have got the modern gadgets. We have got wonderful anesthesia workstations. My colleagues from corporate hospitals have a very hi-fi kind of machines. But let's go down to the basics, because the basic remains the same, and we need to understand the basics very well. So let's concentrate down next 40 minutes for the uptake and distribution of inhaled anesthetics. Now, when we say uptake and distribution, what is exactly a dose of an inhaled anesthetic? Is it the delivered or a dialed concentration? Or is it the concentration in the circuit that is an inspired concentration? Or is it the alveolar concentration? Or is it the arterial concentration? What is it? Can anybody tell me? Alveolar concentration, very good. So it is the partial pressure of the anesthetic agent in the alveolar gas, which is very, very important, because it is directly proportional to the fractional concentration in a gas mixture, and it is measured on an absolute scale of pressure. So when we are at a 760 millimeters mercury atmospheric pressure, that is at the sea level, when we say the partial pressure of N2, that is nitrogen, is 0.79 atmosphere, that is means 0.79 is the fractional nitrogen concentration. Or oxygen, 0.21 atmosphere, means fractional concentration of oxygen is 0.21. Now we have to understand that the partial pressure is actually the driving force for the diffusion of gases across the permeable membrane into the other gases, liquids, or the tissues. And at equilibrium, the partial pressure of any gas is equal in all intercommunicating compartments. That is, all this gas, tissues, liquid are interconnected. And when we work with the anesthesia machine, it is a cyclic multi-compartmental system. So, anesthetic partial pressure in one compartment is the upstream. So, anesthesia machine is upstream to the breathing circuit. Breathing circuit is upstream to the patient's body. And the patient body becomes upstream to the anesthesia machine. So at equilibrium, the partial pressure of any gas will be equal in all these intercommunicating compartments. Now this partial pressure of an inhaled anesthetic is proportional to the concentration in the liquid, that is blood, or in the tissue phases, that is a brain, where concentration is usually defined as either weight, volume, or moles of the drug, per volume of the liquid or tissue. So does that mean that if the partial pressures are equal in all compartments, does it mean that the mean concentrations are equal? What do you have to say? Any PG students? No? It doesn't mean the same. For example, if you take 1 ml of gas, it can contain 0.020 ml of isoflurane, whereas the blood gas solubility is higher, so 1 ml of blood contains 0.030 ml of isoflurane. What does that mean? 1 ml of blood contains equivalent amount of isoflurane as 1.5 ml of air. Is that clear? Is it clear? Yeah. So, coming down to this again, the first slide, the arterial concentration is not equal to alveolar concentration, which is not equal to inspired concentration, which is not equal to the delivered concentration. So let's go back. What does determine the FI, that is the inspired concentration? If you dial more concentration, or if the circuit is having a less concentration, means if the difference between P delivered and P circuit is more, then obviously the inspired concentration will be high. If you increase the fresh gas flow, the inspired concentration will be high. If you increase the breathing circuit volume, obviously the inspired concentration will become less. If you have a more absorbent in the circuit, inspired concentration will be less. So to have some fun, first diagram is a normal one. That balloon is in the form of the circuit, and that is a green is a flow. So first one, look at the speed. Okay, Now, if I'm going to increase the circuit volume, or if I'm going to put a moist soda lime, if the absorbent content will be high, then obviously circuit will take time to build up the FI. Now, suppose in a third diagram, I have shown the flow rate, which is quite high in a large green colored bar. How fast it has come down? So FI has increased faster. So that means if I increase the fresh gas flow, or if I reduce the breathing circuit volume, or if I decrease the absorption in the circuit, I will have a faster induction and faster recovery. Now, before we understand further, we have to understand the basic, that is a time constant. It is the equilibration between two compartments, which is quantitatively described as an exponential equation, which is characterized by the time constant tau. After each time constant, the difference between the upstream and downstream concentration will be reduced by approximately 63%. So P downstream is equal to pressure upstream multiplied by 1 minus exponential of minus T by tau, where time is represented as T, which is the elapsed time measured from when the anesthetic is turned on during induction, and tau, that is a time constant, is nothing but volume of the circuit divided by flow. After 5 time constant have elapsed, the difference between upstream and downstream compartment will diminish by 1%. So if, let's take, most of the time the circuit system volume is 6 liters, at a fresh gas flow of 6 liters per minute, tau will be volume divided by flow, so 6 by 6 is equal to 1 minute. So if I take a 5 constant, time constant, means 5 into 1 is equal to 5 minutes. So it will take 5 minutes for FI to become equal as delivered concentration. Now suppose, if I reduce the flow, fresh gas flow rate to just 1 liter per minute, then what will happen to tau? Tau will be 6 liters volume divided by flow, that is 1 liter per minute. So tau will be equal to 6. And it will take 5 time constants. So 6 into 5, 30 minutes it will take. That is the reason I assume now most of the PG students must have understood why we say that we have to have a high fresh gas flow initially, and then we can go down to the lower gas fresh gas flows. Impact of this fresh gas flow can be easily seen in this particular diagram. As you can see over here, as the fresh gas flow is reduced, more and more time it will take for the circuit concentration to build up. Now, if the circuit is connected to the patient, then obviously patient is taking up some gases, so it will reduce the further, that means it will increase the time for taking for the alveolar concentration to build up. It will also depend on the type of the circuit. If I'm taking an open circuit, the faster rise in the alveolar concentration will be there. Whereas in the second diagram, I've shown the rebreathing circuit, obviously there'll be lesser rise in the alveolar concentration. Now to understand it further, high fresh gas flow means fresh gas flow which is more than the minute volume. So if I'm keeping a high fresh gas flow of total 6 liters per minute, and if I've dialed the sevoflurane concentration to 2%, then what would happen? The bellows will fill with only fresh gas. So in that case, my inspired concentration will be immediately 2%. Dialed concentration is equal to inspired concentration. FI is equal to FD, so I'm in a controlled situation. Whereas if I reduce the fresh gas flow to low fresh gas flow, which is less than the minute volume, and I'm keeping the sevoflurane concentration, a dialed concentration on the vaporizer 2%, what would happen? The bellows will fill with the fresh gas, plus that pink colored exhaled gas it is filling up. So my inspired concentration will be less than 2%. That means to maintain the same FI, and thus the alveolar concentration, I'll have to increase the delivered concentration. So I'll have to dial the concentration to 3%, as you can see over here. That means my FD is more than FI, so there is a loss of control. Okay. Now, initially you are starting with the higher fresh gas flows. Okay. Then when you reduce the fresh gas flow, as you can see in this particular picture, on your left side, the fresh gas flow is 6 liters per minute. And on your right side, you have reduced to 1.5 liters per minute. So what has happened? The rise in the alveolar concentration has reduced. So it will not reach to the proper concentration in the alveoli and hence in the brain. So I need to increase the vaporizer setting. Now, if it is a some agent like desflurane, I need to increase only by 10%, whereas if it is an isoflurane, I need to increase it by 40% nearly. Okay, now let's understand further. Fractional alveolar concentration is proportional to partial pressure of anesthetic in the lung, which is proportional to partial pressure of anesthetic in the brain, which is proportional to the fractional concentration in the brain. So ultimately, partial pressure of the anesthetic in the lung is the driving pressure. So you have to try and maintain the partial pressure of anesthetic in the lung. So this is the driving pressure. So now let us see, if it is the driving pressure, what are the factors which are determining this fractional concentration in the alveoli? Now, if you can see in the diagram, the alveolar concentration determinants are, first of all, if you increase the inspired concentration, obviously alveolar concentration will increase. If the uptake in the patient's circulation is more, then there will be lesser rise in the alveolar concentration. If you increase the ventilation, there will be faster rise, and there is something called concentration and second guess effect. Now, uptake initially is equal to zero. So that time, the alveolar concentration will fast rise, FA will become equal to FI. Then, as the patient starts taking up, uptake is there in the circulation, obviously, the speed of rise will reduce. So here, the FA will slowly increase and then become closer to FI. Now, if suppose everything is taken up by the body, uptake is 100%, FA will never reach to FI, okay? Now, if that is so, let us understand what are the factors which are affecting the uptake. So, uptake is equal to lambda plus gas solubility multiplied by cardiac output multiplied by the alveolar to venous blood concentration difference. So, let us understand one by one factor. Now, in this diagram, the yellow is a sevoflurane color and red is the halothane color. Now, in the first diagram, as you can see over here, sevoflurane, all of you know, it has a low blood gas solubility, so it is taken up less in the blood. So in the circulation, in the aero, you are seeing only 4 moles, okay? So what has happened? There is a, this thing, faster rise in the alveolar concentration and hence faster rise in the brain. Whereas the next diagram is the halothane. Halothane is more soluble, it is taken up in the more in the blood, as you can see in that red color arrow. So the concentration in the lung is rising slowly and hence concentration in the blood is rising slowly. Okay, you know all which are more soluble, which are less soluble. So as you can see in these particular curves, obviously the nitrous oxide desflurane, they have a fast rise in the alveolar concentration compared to isoflurane and flurane halothane. Now, second factor was cardiac output. Now cardiac output, imagine it is a less soluble agent. In the first figure, you have a cardiac output which is normal. In the second figure, the patient has got hypertension, cardiac output is low. What would happen? Because as such, it is a less soluble blood, sevoflurane is not taken up so much in the blood. So, okay, there is some rise in the lung concentration, but not so much. Okay, so brain concentration has become little more, but not to a gross extent. Whereas if you see something like a halothane, halothane is taken up so much by the blood. Now, if there is a less of a cardiac output for some reason, what is going to happen? It's not going to be taken up so much by the blood. So there is much more rise in the lung concentration and much more rise in the brain concentration. Now, this will cause what? If the patient is breathing spontaneously, obviously there'll be respiratory depression. So it is going to be a safety mechanism. But if you are giving IPPR, there'll be so much faster rise and you can have a cardiac arrest. Okay, so this is to be understandable. Then, so as you can see further in the curve, the evidence is showing that when as you go from 10 liters to 5 liters to 2.5 liters of this thing, isoflurane, there is a faster rise in the alveolar concentration. Now, this is against the common logic. Common logic says that when there is an increase in the cardiac output, it results in the more rapid delivery of anesthetic to the major sites of action in the nervous system. So anesthesia induction is faster, not slower. This is a common logic. But I have explained you, this is not correct. So when you are using agent like halothane especially, and if the cardiac output is reduced, then the alveolar concentration will rise faster and hence the concentration in the brain will rise faster. Okay? During induction, this I have already explained, I'll not go further. Now what happens to that extra anesthetic which is gone in the circulation? Now this is going to go into the muscle and fat tissue, which will take hours to equilibrate with the alveolar concentration. So this is going to absorb the additional agent. Now the third factor was, first factor was blood gas solubility. Second factor was cardiac output. So third factor is the alveolar to venous blood content difference. Now this again is dependent on the tissue solubility, tissue blood flow, and the difference in the partial pressure between the arterial blood and the tissue. Understood? So let us understand with the water analog. Now this water analog, the first picture is a mouth. You are giving the high flow of inhaled anesthetic agent. The second vessel is a lung. So lung will start slowly getting filled up. Now the lighter color is the filling up with the anesthetic agent. Now the visceral compartment, the vessel rich group, is having a high blood flow as shown with the large red colored this. Okay. So here it will start filling up. Once this starts get filling up, it will go to the muscle compartment. This will start getting filling up. And last it will go to the fat compartment, and fat compartment will start getting filled up. Now this, the vessel rich group, it is only 10% of the body mass, but it is having a very high cardiac output, 75% of cardiac output. And that is how there is a fast in and out and there is a rapid equilibrium. Okay. Now let us understand what happens with the least soluble gases, like agent like sevoflurane. Sevoflurane, it will faster rise in the lung, faster rise in the brain, and then it will start going to the muscle and fat. But if you are using something like a halothane, it will take slow rise. Here only half of the lung is full, and hence only half of the brain is full, and the muscle has hardly got anything and fat has got nothing. Okay. Now what happens is, the brain has such a large amount of cardiac output is there, plus the brain blood partition coefficient is just 1.7, whereas the muscle has a very less blood flow, but the muscle partition coefficient is 3.1 times. So equilibration is not simply 20 times longer in the muscle, but it is 20 multiplied by 3.1 divided by 1.7. So 36 times longer it will take to equilibrate in the muscle compartment. Is that getting clear? Yeah. So the half time to equilibrium in the vessel rich group is just 1 minute for nitrous oxide and 2 minutes for sevoflurane. The longer time to equilibrate with the sevoflurane results from the higher tissue blood partition coefficient. Equilibration of the vessel rich group with the anesthetic partial pressure in the arterial blood is more than 90% complete within just 4 to 8 minutes. Muscle compartment takes some time, so it takes 40 to 50 minutes for nitrous oxide and 140 to 160 minutes for sevoflurane or isoflurane. And what about fat compartment? It has a large capacity and a less blood flow, so 70 to 80 minutes for nitrous oxide and 30 hours for sevoflurane or isoflurane. So equilibrium with fat does not occur in the course of anesthesia with most of the potent inhaled anesthetic agents, because you are not having a surgeries more than 30 hours going on. So the circuit concentration will rise first, next is alveoli, next is brain, then muscle, and then the fat. So what happens? Now, initially, the content difference between the alveoli and venous blood is zero. Okay, so there's no uptake. So if there is no uptake, the alveolar concentration is going to rise fast. So as you can see, initially it has sharp rise in the alveolar concentration. Then what happens is, next is the vessel rich group followed by muscle group and fat group starts taking. So your rise is little slowed down now. And then they also start getting saturated, but the fat compartment more and more is going. So it is a further slowing down in the rise in the alveolar concentration is there. Okay. So as you can see over here in this particular figure, within 1 minute, there is a sharp rise initially in the lung, and then by 8 minutes, most of the vessel rich group starts getting a good concentration of the this thing, anesthetic agent. So if you increase the FI, inspired concentration, then there'll be increase in the rate and height of the rise will be there. Now practically, how do we conduct? So initially, let us see this. Now, patient is receiving 70% of nitrous oxide. So half of the MEC is going to be provided by nitrous oxide and patient is getting isoflurane. So you want half of the MEC to be provided by isoflurane. As you all know, this MEC value is 1.3 for isoflurane. So half of the MEC means you want actually 0.65 of isoflurane, okay? So initial first vaporizer setting is 3% isoflurane. Second vaporizer setting is 1.5%, and a third vaporizer setting is 1%. That's how we normally do use. Now, why this is so? The first vaporizing setting of 3%, if you don't reduce, then what will happen? The constant alveolar concentration will be about more than 1.5, 1.8, which is not needed, as I've shown. If you keep the second vaporizer setting of 1.5 constant, then again, you will get a alveolar concentration of 1%, which is not needed. You want only 0.65. That means you need to decrease the this thing setting to about 1%. That will reduce to 0.65 MEC in the alveoli. So initially for 1 minute, you set it at 3%. Then for next 4 or 5 minutes, you set it at around 1.5%. And then you set it at 1%. That will give you 0.65 MEC of isoflurane. Rest MEC will be provided by nitrous oxide because at least you need 1.3 MEC for anesthesia. Okay, so this is called overpressure because you are initially giving a high concentration. That's why in my water analog model, you saw that it was the mouth, it had an overflowing because I'm giving a high pressure. Okay, as you can see over here, can you see? It is overflowing because we are giving a initial high concentration. So you give initially lots of sevoflurane, so it will go fast to the mouth, fast to the lungs, and the concentration in the viscera will reach very faster. That is the purpose of giving high concentration of sevoflurane or isoflurane, any anesthetic agent you have to give initially in the higher concentration. Now some amount is taken up by the lungs, so how do you overcome? So this lowering of alveolar partial pressure by uptake can be countered by the increasing ventilation. Now, as you can see over here, this is a normal ventilation. How much is the sevoflurane? There are 8 bowls. Now I have increased the ventilation. The sevoflurane, there are 10 bowls over here. So the concentration in the brain also has increased further. Now, for agent like halothane, when this is happening, if the patient is on a spontaneous breathing, then it will cause ventilatory depression and automatically patient cannot take further. So it becomes a safety mechanism. But if you are ventilating and if you are giving a very high concentration of halothane, you had it. You will get a bradycardia and cardiac arrest. So you can see over here, when you are desflurane, you are doubling the ventilation. It's not so much of difference. Whereas isoflurane, when you are doubling the ventilation, the rise in the alveolar concentration has become a very, very fast. Now let's come down and understand concentration and second guess effect. Why are we using nitrous oxide? Now what happens is, initially when we are giving, for example, say 29% oxygen, 70% nitrous oxide, and 1% isoflurane. Now what would happen because you are giving high nitrous oxide, okay? Now suppose the 35 of the nitrous oxide is taken up by the body, the alveolar volume will reduce to 65. So the nitrous oxide percentage has become 53.9%. That means concentration of nitrous oxide has occurred. Okay, now this will cause augmentation of the inspired ventilation. 35 ml more of the gases will be taken up. So along with that, 24.5 of oxygen, 10.2 of nitrous, and 0.3 of the isoflurane also will be taken up. That means what would happen? 1 plus 0.3, ultimately it has become 1.3. So this has come to 1.3%. So instead of 1% isoflurane, now actually the 1.3% is going in because you are using nitrous oxide. So this is called the second guess effect. I hope everybody has understood concentration and second guess effect. Yes or no? There's no this thing answer, so I can't make out. In the interest of time, I'll have to continue. So as you can see over here, the desflurane, when you are giving in the 5% nitrous oxide, see how slowly it is rising, whereas when you are giving with 65% nitrous oxide, it is rising very fast. Okay? Now, let us understand why the nitrous oxide is causing the increase in the all your gas bubble size. Now what happens is, nitrous oxide is much more soluble. Initially the gas bubble is filled with the air, it is containing nitrogen. So here three nitrogen are there and there are outside some nitrous oxide. Now the nitrous oxide is going in and occupying some space over here, but nitrogen cannot come out. So obviously it has become nitrogen plus nitrous oxide, so the volume has become twice. Then still some more nitrous oxide is going in, nitrogen is still not able to come out, so it has become three times size. That's how the, when you are using nitrous oxide, the gas bubble size keeps on increasing. Now, I'm a fond of pediatric anesthesia, so obviously I can't resist myself. What happens in the children? Children have a high ventilation per kg body weight, they have a higher cardiac output. So ventilation should rise faster, alveolar concentration, but cardiac output is high. But cardiac output is more higher in the vessel rich group in the children. So that is how overall in children, the induction is much faster. Induction as well as recovery is faster compared to the adults. Now what happens during the end of the case? End of the case, everything should be opposite. True? So is it everything opposite? Because this thing should come from the brain to back to the thing. Let us understand the difference. The first one is we are inducing the patient. All the sevoflurane balls are nicely flowing down to the brain. Muscle, it continues to go to the muscle fat. Now I'm reversing. At the end of the procedure, what would happen? Sevoflurane from lung is going back to the machine, but from lung it is still going to the muscle also. So exactly the procedure is not reverse, it is not the mirror image. Okay? Some are still continuing. So I can use overpressure technique, but I cannot during reversal, I cannot go below sub atmosphere for the inhaled agent. So it is not exactly the mirror image. Okay? So no overpressure can be applied during recovery. Then prior to induction, partial pressure of the inhaled agent in all other tissue is zero. Whereas during the reversal procedure, means at the end of the case, brain has a different concentration, muscle has a different concentration, fat has a third type of concentration, everything is not same. Okay, now coming back to this water analog model, let us see what is happening. Now longer the anesthetic, the slower the clearance, because more and more of your anesthetic has gone into the muscle compartment, fat compartment. Okay, so there the context sensitivity clearance comes into the picture. So obese the patient you have, or higher muscular patient you have, they will have a slow emergence from the anesthetic compared to your thin, lean patient with the less muscular mass. Okay, and as you can see over here, if the agent is a least soluble, it is not having a so much of effect. But if the agent is a highly soluble, like isoflurane, halothane, then at the end of 4-hour case, it is not like a 30-minute case. At the end of 4-hour case, it is taking time. I'm just going to take 3 minutes more before you warn me. Now we are reversing the patient. Okay, I'm switching off the nitrous oxide. Now concentrate here. I'm shutting off the nitrous oxide. So what is happening? All my nitrous oxide molecules are coming back slowly. I can enjoy. They are all coming back to the lungs. So what is happening? They are diluting my white colored balls, oxygen. So this is the dilution of oxygen. My gray colored balls also have come in a minority now. Those are carbon dioxide. So obviously they cannot stimulate the respiration. So this is a diffusion hypoxia. I hope all your first year residents have understood wherever they are coming from. Now the last concept, that is the minimum alveolar concentration. Minimum alveolar concentration of inhaled anesthetic is the one which prevents the movement in the half of the subject in response to a surgical incision. So it is effective dose in a 50%, like how we say ED50 for an IV agent, that way it is a MAC. But what about rest of the 50%? Are you going to keep them mobile and kicking away the surgeon just because you don't like, you want the patient also to kick? No. So you have to give 1.3 MAC. That is the reason. So 1 MAC is inadequate to prevent movement in the half of the patient. So ED95 dose you have to give, which is approximately 1.3 into MAC. Is that clear to everybody? Okay. Now what is a MAC awake? It is the concentration of inhaled anesthetic that inhibits appropriate responses to spoken commands in half of the patient. So MAC awake has been measured both during induction of anesthesia, that is a loss of response, and during emergence from anesthesia, that is recovery of the response. And the ratio of MAC awake to MAC is not uniform for inhaled agents, okay? But for most of the halogenated agent, it is around 0.35 MAC. Luckily for nitrous oxide, it is around how much? How much? One of the resident? Nobody wants to answer. It's around 0.65 to 0.7, okay? So functional recovery from anesthesia is determined by MAC awake for the specific agent as well as the elimination kinetics. Time needed to wake up after an anesthetic, especially a long one, depends on what concentration of anesthetic was inhaled relative to the MAC awake. So if the inhaled concentration was about twice the MAC value awake, then only 50% reduction in the P alveoli will be needed. So you'll have a fast recovery. But if you have if you are giving a higher inhaled anesthetic concentration, then it will take proportionately longer time because it has gone to the muscle, fat compartments, etc. What is MAC bar? That is used for during surgical incision. Okay, so that is about 1.66. So in conclusion, dose of an inhaled anesthetic is P alveoli. FI depends on the delivered concentration, fresh gas flow, breathing circuit volume, and the type of the circuit. FA depends on the FI, uptake, ventilation, and concentration and second gas effect. Uptake depends on blood gas solubility multiplied by cardiac output multiplied by difference in the alveoli to venous blood, and content concentration difference between alveoli to venous blood depends on tissue uptake, which depends on tissue solubility, tissue blood flow, and the partial pressure difference between artery to tissue. Then overpressure technique and hyperventilation can increase the speed of induction. Okay, although elimination is reverse of uptake, there are few differences. You cannot apply overpressure technique and tissues are at different concentrations. And it is important to understand the context sensitivity clearance and diffusion hypoxia. If that is understood, I think you can practice anesthesia very well, whether you are coming to my institute, that is LTMMC, belonging to MCGM group of hospital, or you go to any of the corporate hospitals. Thank you very much. Or even if you